You sounded real good on that record, Elvis, Gladys said softly as the turntable spun to a stop. I think you might just have something special there. Elvis smiled and hugged his mother. Thanks, Mama. I sure hope folks like it. Despite the excitement and validation of hearing himself on a real pressed record, doubts still nagged at him. Would people get his unique blend of blues, country, and something else entirely? Or would they just think it sounded weird coming from a white boy? He remembered the surprised reactions from Scotty, Bill, and Sam that night in the studio when he started messing around with, "That's all right." It was like they had stumbled onto a whole new sound without even meaning to. But maybe it was too different, too out there. The way some folks talked, you'd think the only two types of music in the world were hillbilly and race records, as separate as black and white. What Elvis and the boys had created didn't fit neatly into either box. Still, Dewey Phillips seemed to dig it. The flamboyant DJ had played "That's All Right" over and over on his show, building up the mystery of this new singer that some callers thought must be colored. Elvis chuckled to himself, remembering how Dewey had tricked him into that live radio interview, his first ever. The nerves had jangled through him like an out-of-tune guitar, but he'd managed not to sound like a total hayseed. He knew these next few days and weeks would determine if "That's All Right" was just a flash in the pan or the start of something big. It all depended on whether people took to this crazy mashup of styles and to him. Elvis Presley, a nobody truck driver from the wrong side of the tracks, daring to blur the lines between black and white music. It seemed like an awful lot to stake on one little record, but Mama's faith in him was absolute. She'd been telling him for years that he had a rare gift, that he could be somebody. Remembering her words now filled him with a fragile hope. Maybe, just maybe, this was his shot. Elvis carefully slid the record back into its paper sleeve. Guess we'll find out soon enough if they like it. He kissed Gladys on the cheek and headed to his room, but sleep proved elusive. His mind kept drifting back to that magical night in the Sun studio. In his head, he could still hear Scotty's bright guitar licks, Bill slapping that big old bass, Sam coaxing and encouraging him from the control room. It had felt so good, so right, making music with those guys, like they were tapping into something deep and true and totally new. Elvis knew that feeling was worth chasing, no matter how many doors got slammed in his face. He'd scratched and scrambled for every opportunity in his short life, from shining shoes on the street corner to working any odd job he could find. Singing was the only thing that made him feel truly alive inside. Not even the sting of being turned away by other record labels could shake his conviction that music was his calling. As he finally drifted off to sleep, Elvis made a quiet promise to himself. Come what may, he'd never stop reaching for that feeling he'd found at Sun, for those fleeting moments when all the doubt and struggle fell away, and he was able to pour his whole heart into a song. He didn't know if it would make him a star or even pay the bills, but he knew now he had to try. It was almost like his whole life up till now, the hardships, the odd jobs, the yearning for something more had been leading him to this. The next morning, he headed to the Crown Electric Warehouse, same as always, but everything felt different. The old Milton was full of nervous energy. The radio tuned to WHBQ in hopes of catching another spin of "That's All Right." When Elvis walked in, the other guys ribbed him good-naturedly about his sudden singing career. He laughed along, secretly thrilled to finally be singled out for something other than his flashy clothes. Working mindless manual labor was even harder than usual that day, with his head so full of music and plans and big dreams. Stacking crates and hauling boxes, he imagined himself on stage in front of screaming crowds, signing autographs for fans, seeing his name on marquees and headlines. It seemed impossible, but then again, so had cutting a record just a few days ago. If Sam Phillips really did see something special in him, who knew how far he could go? Over the next couple weeks, as "That's All Right" gained traction on Memphis radio and in local record stores, Elvis got his first intoxicating taste of fame. Girls who once wouldn't give him a second look now flirted and asked for his autograph. Strangers stopped him on the street to say how much they liked his song. At the corner drugstore, he overheard some kids arguing over whether he was white or black, and it made him laugh out loud. Let him wonder, he thought. Didn't matter to him what folks called it, as long as they dug the music. And more of them did, as the record took off that summer of 54. Elvis played his first real concerts in Memphis to ecstatic crowds, Scotty and Bill backing him with a raw energy that threatened to blow the roof off. On stage, he shimmied and shook, channeling the Rush in a way that felt scandalous and thrilling, almost holy. The girls went wild, screaming his name, trying to grab him or even cut off a lock of his hair. It was a long way from singing Old Shep at the Mississippi-Alabama State Fair. Even as his star rose in Memphis, Elvis itched to conquer new worlds. He talked Sam's ear off about hitting the road, taking the music to the people, maybe even going all the way to New York City. Caught up in the excitement himself, Sam agreed to be his manager. He started booking Elvis and the band at state fairs and small-town beer joints across the South, hard traveling for low pay, but a chance to win new fans one show at a time. It was a far cry from the glamorous life Elvis dreamed about, bouncing in the back of a station wagon from one gig to the next, setting up their own gear, sometimes playing for just a handful of sleepy patrons. But something kept pushing him on, a raw hunger for more, a sense that he was reaching for a destiny bigger than himself. The road took them from Texarkana to Shreveport to Meridian and beyond. With each new crowd, Elvis had to win them over all over again. Ignoring the catcalls and indifference, he poured everything he had into the music, shaking and gyrating with wild abandon. By the end of the night, they were converts, shelling out their hard-earned cash for a copy of that record by Elvis Presley. Not everyone got it, of course. Plenty of show promoters took one look at Elvis in his flashy clothes and pompadour haircut and wrote him off as a joke. Some nights, the crowd just stared back in stony silence, unmoved by the frenzy coming off the stage. It only made Elvis work harder, sing with more passion and heart and soul. He knew he had something special to give. He just needed a chance to be heard. Slowly but surely, the grind started to pay off. The crowds got bigger, the response more fervent. Little girls screamed and grown women swooned, while the men gaped with a mixture of envy and awe. After the shows, fans thronged the makeshift stage, hungry for a smile or wink from Elvis, maybe an autograph if they were lucky. A buzz started to build. Sun Records shipped more and more copies of That's All Right and Blue Moon of Kentucky, feeding the growing demand. Elvis put everything he earned back into fancy new clothes and a big shiny car, a 1954 pink Cadillac, an outlandish color for an automobile, but he loved how it made people stop and stare. Cruising the streets of Memphis with a pretty girl by his side, he felt like he'd really made it. Only he knew he was just getting started. As that summer of 54 stretched into fall, Elvis had his eye on bigger things. The Grand Ole Opry in Nashville, maybe even the Louisiana Hayride out of Shreveport. Those were the real proving grounds where stars were born. He knew he could hold his own with the likes of Hank Snow and Farron Young. All he needed was a chance. Came sooner than he expected. One day in early October, Sam called him into the Sun studio with news that made Elvis's head spin. The Grand Ole Opry wanted him as a guest performer, not headlining, but it was a foot in the door. At the same time, the Hayride offered him a regular weekly gig for union-scale pay. It was more money than Elvis had ever seen. He barely had to think about it. The Opry was a one-shot. The Hayride meant steady exposure to a huge audience across the South. And Shreveport was closer to Memphis than Nashville. He could still come home to see his folks on occasion. With a whoop, he told Sam to sign him up. He'd never played to a crowd half that big. Waiting in the wings, he peeked out at a sea of expectant faces, his stomach doing dips and flutters. But the moment he strode on stage, some switch flipped inside him. An electric current shot through his veins, a jolt of pure adrenaline. He launched into That's All Right with the force of a coiled spring, unleashing all his pent-up energy. Elvis shimmied and shook, fingers flying over the frets of his guitar, the crowd's shrieks and whistles urging him on. By the end of the set, he was down on his knees, spent and ecstatic, basking in the frenzied roar of approval. He knew right then he had them in the palm of his hand. Backstage afterwards, flushed with sweat and triumph, Elvis overheard one of the Hayride honchos marveling, "This boy's got something. I don't know what it is, but whatever it is, it's gonna make him a star." He ducked his head, grinning so wide his cheeks hurt, let them wonder, all the naysayers and stuffed shirts. He was gonna make them eat those words. This was just the start of proving what Elvis Presley could do. A poor truck driver from Tupelo who didn't know his place, didn't fit in any box. He was gonna make music no one had ever heard before. And the whole world was gonna love it, whether they were ready or not. Heading back to Memphis that night, radio crackling with static, Elvis watched the inky southern night roll by and dreamed about the future stretching ahead of him, bright as stage lights. However twisty the road got, he'd never forget what it felt like right now, on the razor's edge between obscurity and glory. This moment belonged to a boy who dared to believe in his own destiny, and he aimed to make it count.